Right. Coming up next, we have Brian Fox. Brian, I'm going to get you on the focus here. Thank you. Brian, if you don't know him yet, is the CTO of Sonatype, but he's also the founder of the company and helped create the tools. Brian, I'm checking in with you here to make sure that everything's working with you. There you go. I see
hey,
you
Mark.
There. Hey, how are you? Morning.
Good morning. Everybody.
There you go. I can hear you good. It looks like a Tesla I was seeing there. There we go.
Oh, yeah. That's my background. What's that? Starman flying out to Mars in a Tesla? Yeah. Good picture.
All right. So, I introduced you a little, but give people some background and get yourself going.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for joining us early or late or wherever you are. A little bit of history. The co-founders of Sonatype, our backgrounds go all the way back into Apache Maven in the early 2000s. When we started the company in 2007, we were doing a lot of Maven training and consulting in those days. But the relevant part for what I'm going to talk about today is really in that whole time, we've been the stewards of the central repository, or people may know it as Maven Central, which is the largest Java open source repository in the world. And we have now well over a decade and a half of experience in running that and dealing with the implications of having such a huge honeypot of components, and understanding what the trends are across the ecosystems. And these are the download statistics for Central. So way, way back when we first started the company, we were down at like 500 million downloads a year. And we thought I was doing training and consulting. And now last year we topped 87 billion downloads, right? And so this open source component trend is clearly exploding. More and more people are using open source every single day. It feels to some of us like, this is old hat, but clearly these numbers show that it's still increasing. And if you were to overlay the NPM downloads, for example, because the units are much smaller, the numbers are higher, but it shows a hockey stick curve, and pretty much any of the repos these days show the same kinds of thing, right? So this is all good. We're using more and more open source. Presumably, we're getting more efficient as an industry in providing value, because we've mostly not had to keep rewriting the same things over and over again. But that comes with some downsides and some unintended consequences that I'm going to talk about to try and raise awareness. So in this story, along the security vein, it kind of starts in 2013. So, a few years prior to this, we started looking into the consumption patterns of open source components from Central. Our CEO, Wayne Jackson, his background is in security, and he started looking at the logs and asking us questions like, why is it that the most vulnerable versions of, component X also happen to be the most popular? Why is it that people aren't actively moving to less risky components? And so that kind of set us down a path that led to some of the products that we have today. But in the early days, when we would talk to people about security and components, there were the answers were somewhat mixed. Some people would say, well, we're not even using open source, without realizing that their developers were using Maven and consuming massive amounts of open source underneath the hood. Or if they were aware of open source, they kind of denied that there were vulnerabilities or security implications of those, and that, or it was covered by tools we have, or web application firewalls, or something like that, right? So this was the general understanding of the ecosystem in 2011, 2012. And that started to change, unfortunately, in 2013 with the first high-profile Struts vulnerability that had been announced. And this one was somewhat scary and unique, because the vulnerability existed inside of the Struts framework itself, right? And so for those that aren't familiar with Struts, Struts is a fairly popular MVP web application framework for Java, right? It was very, very popular in the early 2000s, Struts 1 and Struts 2. So there are a lot of applications out there, even today, that are still built on this infrastructure. And this particular vulnerability basically was kind of the worst case scenario. It was network exploitable, was anonymously exploitable, and it allowed you basically to upload and execute code. And because the vulnerability existed inside of the framework itself, which was doing the actual processing of the request, it didn't matter what your code was. Like, you could literally have a Hello World application running. There was nothing you could do to protect from it inside of your own code and still get exploited. And so, you know, the Apache Struts team and the Apache security team, they do a great job dealing with zero-day, you know, disclosures. This vulnerability itself was responsibly disclosed to the team, and they did the right thing. They have a very thorough checklist of how they go and fix it and you know, make sure the release is out there, and then they do the announcement and the CVEs are out there, and they did all the things right. Unfortunately, there was widespread compromise of this particular vulnerability post-disclosure. Now, this one started to be exploited, you know, some number of weeks and months, and the long tail of that lasted maybe even to today, who knows. But the point being that it was after the disclosure that happened, after the responsible disclosure and a zero-day process had been followed, that's when lots of companies started to get attacked. And so this is a screenshot here of the Struts vulnerability being built right into a Chinese hacking toolkit. And so literally, you didn't even have to know anything. You just like click a button, put in a URL, and boom, you've got a shell on a server running this. And so that's as bad as it can get. And so it got so bad, the FBI had to issue a field alert to their staff to let them know that lots of banks and things like that were being exploited via this vulnerability, right? So point being here, even when the responsible disclosure, even when the zero day is done, when the project does all the things right, after the disclosure is when the bad guys pick this stuff up. And it kind of makes sense if you think of the economics of it, right? The more and more we start building on top of common infrastructure of these different components, the more and more we're basically producing a common mode failure, where a single vulnerability in a massively distributed, massively used popular framework becomes a highly leveraged activity for the bad guys, right? They don't have to sit down and figure out how to crack your website. They can go find one of these attacking kits and go search the internet for anything that is using Struts, which, if you know how to use Google, is not that hard to do. And so, you know, you don't have to pick a particular target. You basically are just fishing across the internet for what's vulnerable, and then you figure out how you exploit it, right? So that's what's happening as we build up on top of these popular frameworks. And so, you know, fast forward to the following year. So we've got 2014. This was when Heartbleed happened in OpenSSL, right? And we saw how prevalent that was, because that code that was affected had been out for, what, a decade or something like that? And Shellshock, too. I think Shellshock, the vulnerability in Shellshock had been there longer than I was a developer, right? It predated me graduating. And so, you know, these things were highly prevalent across all different types of ecosystems. And I think, you know, these ones were the first vulnerabilities that kind of had names and logos attached to them, which was potentially helpful in driving awareness. You know, and so Heartbleed, the high profile attacks from Heartbleed were things like the Canadian Tax Authority getting shut down days before tax day. And things like that. And so I think these types of attacks, unfortunately, started to raise awareness in the industry that open source components had risk that needed to be dealt with. It wasn't just custom code. It wasn't just network exploits that you had to be looking at. You had to be looking inside these components. But it also kind of showed that the bad guys were figuring that out too. Right. So following year, this was the year of Commons Collections. Right. And Commons Collections was used in lots and lots of stuff, including JBoss and Oracle's stuff, and IBM WebSphere, I think, also had it. And so this background picture is Hollywood Presbyterian Hospital. And they actually were the victims of a ransomware attack. And after the investigation, it was found that the attackers got in through Commons Collections in JBoss and were able to then inject and execute Shodan and basically, you know, insert the ransomware. And, you know, they shut down the hospital. Surgeries had to be canceled. Labs were locked. Patient records were locked. People potentially had to be diverted because the emergency rooms had to be shut down. Right. And you know, we always say it has to get to the point where people die before we start paying attention. You know, no matter what problem it is, whether it's food or car safety or airline safety. And here it is right here, right? So while we probably can't tell you the exact people who may have died from these types of attacks here or in Mercy Hospital in the UK, there are lots of studies that have shown on marathon days, for example, when ambulances have to be diverted around a marathon and they add minutes to the delays to getting patients to the hospital, that the mortality rates, you know, 30, 60, 90 days out, are statistically significant. That shows that those types of events kill people. And so here you have a hospital who has their entire thing shut down because of a vulnerability in an application server that, by the way, had been known and announced a long time prior to when this was actually exploited. That's pretty severe, right? And you know, we still see even you know, several years later, attacks coming out where people are still leveraging these things. So again, the trend here in these years was vulnerabilities were announced and disclosed and fixed. And then there's this long tail where people aren't really responding. They're not updating. And that's when the attacks occur post disclosure. Then of course, earlier last year we had Equifax, right? And so, the thing I want to point out here is that the disclosure came out on March 7th, and the investigation of what happened at Equifax showed that their probing attacks had started on March 9th. Now, it took a long time before they you know, discovered it and worked backwards, but this was a dramatic escalation in the time to exploit or the time before exploiting post-disclosure. And so here you could see some of these trends. This comes from an IBM and Gartner report that shows how that has been going over the years. And Equifax was a dramatic escalation in that, in the severity of that, from, you know, an average of 15 days all the way down to 2 days. And so that's not a great trend. And so if we stop and think about why might this be happening? Right. Let's talk about the economics of cybercrime. And I saw this at a talk earlier at DevNexus from an IBM security researcher named Stephen Poole, and it kind of blew my mind. But, you know, the numbers for cybercrime as compared to the illicit drug trade were nearly equal 2 years ago. Right. So in 2016, the cybercrime industry cost us $450 billion, when at the same time, the worldwide illicit drug trade was only $435 billion. That's pretty bad. And so if you stop and think about that for a moment, you think about what you see on the news, you think about the drug enforcement agencies in all of these different countries and drug cartels and all of the money that we spend as a global population on trying to fight drugs, the narrative is not the same for what's happening in cybercrime. We get upset when our you know, social security numbers and other personal data gets stolen. It becomes headline news, and then people move on and go back. But, you know, 2 years ago, cybercrime was worth more than all of that drug trade. And so the discrepancy in the attention and the amount that we spend on that is enormous. And what's worse, the cybercrime values or the cost to us as a population is expected to increase to $6 trillion in 2020, right? And at the same time, the drug trade is basically just bouncing around at $435 billion, give or take, year over year over year. So we're right on the cusp of an explosion of cybercrime and its cost on humanity. And so, you know, at $6 trillion, that's $800 for every person on the planet. That's pretty profound. So the point being here that we're not dealing with script kiddies who are attacking our applications. These are organized well-funded professionals that are attacking these things. And so we need to take that threat seriously. And so at the same time, we have this new collusion of potential attack vectors, right? So cryptocurrency comes in at the same time that, you know, the existing cybercrime industry is making off with tons of money. And so, you know, I was talking to somebody at one of these trade shows talking about, you know, what we do at Sonatype and this general component attack vector. And their answer was like, yeah, that's pretty scary, but I have nothing of value in my application. Right? My application doesn't have credit card data. It doesn't have personal information data. Pretty sure we've all said that at some point in the past. But cryptocurrency really changes that dynamic in a meaningful way. Your server has CPU cycles. Your visitors have CPU cycles. Your build infrastructure has CPU cycles. And so what's happened is the cryptocurrency has basically allowed the attack itself to be directly monetized. Right, so if you think about what happened with Equifax or even the hospital ultimately ended up paying $17 million in Bitcoin to get their data back. They paid the ransom. In some of these cases, that's chump change. But if you think about what happened with the exfiltration of the Equifax data, somebody has to go on the dark web and take that loot that they've walked away with and actually turn it into money. They have to sell it. They have to pop up somewhere and try to make money off of it. That's usually when criminals get caught, right? It's often not when they're stealing your TV, but it's when they're trying to hawk the TV or sell it on the black market. Cryptocurrency has changed that dynamic completely by allowing people to monetize that directly. And so earlier this year, there was a report, there were some vulnerabilities in Jenkins clusters that had been long known, long fixed, right? Responsible disclosure had been followed. And yet people were still running these older versions out there for a long period of time. And somebody injected miners into them. And that last report, they walked away with $3.4 million. Right, of directly monetized value coming out of this attack. They didn't have to steal anything from Jenkins to make money. And so, you know, it sort of like, you know, don't feed the trolls. This is exactly what's happening with the cryptocurrency. We're making it easier and easier for them to make money off of this stuff, which then further incents additional attention. And so, you know, for the past year or so, every time a significant attack on the ecosystem happened, you know, we were writing about it, I was blogging about it, and it kind of got to the point where I felt like, my goodness, you know, I feel like I'm writing the same blog every single day. It's just a couple of the details have changed. And when you step back and you really look at the trend and what's actually happening, it's really kind of scary. So let's walk through this. Starts about a year ago, July 2017, there was a study that was published that talked about the credentials of publishers to the NPM repository. So 14,000% of it, 79,000 packages at the time. The credentials for the people creating those packages or authorized to write those official packages into the repository either had their credentials checked into GitHub or were subject to an easily compromised dictionary attack. So when I looked at that, the takeaway that I got was that we've suddenly had sort of this massive lowering of the bar of what it takes to get things into these open source repositories and the sharing and the consumption of them. But at the same time, we've made it so easy that people aren't really paying attention to their own best practices, and they're protecting their own credentials, right? It's easy to just come up with an idea, wing-ding together some component and get it out in the repository and find a bunch of users, and then you move on, and you don't think carefully about what actually it means, the care that you have or the duty that you have to have due care over these things. And so, you know, when these developers and publishers get themselves attacked, it puts all of their users at risk. And I don't think people are generally thinking about that, both the developers themselves, but also us as an industry. We're used to consuming open source of things like OpenSSL and Apache, where, you know, these things followed great processes and they were done by very experienced developers. And so the standards and the way they go and the signatures they use are highly secure. That's not the case for most of packages anymore. And that, I think, is not a great trend. So not long after that that study was published, we saw within NPM, this literally happened 2 weeks after the study published, there were 40 packages out there for 2 weeks that were published. Now, they weren't published in official coordinates. They were typo squatted, right? So they created packages that sounded a lot like official ones and put them out there in the hopes that people would use them. Unfortunately, it was effective. In these particular instances, the packages were collecting environment variables, and most notable for me anyway was that there were specific attempts to attack and collect the NPM publisher credentials themselves. So not only were they attacking any users of the packages, they were trying to collect the credentials to publish the official packages. And so that's pretty interesting, as it kind of belies the intent. Just about 4 weeks after that, we saw basically the same thing happen within the PyPI ecosystem. So there were 10 malicious packages, also typo squatted. In this instance, they were collecting basic info and streaming it off to a Chinese IP address. So this is your build infrastructure, your developers, and your users sending information off to China for who knows what purpose, right? So this pattern occurred within just a span of 6 weeks. Fast forward a little bit to the beginning of this year, there was a great blog on HackerMoon with this title, "I'm Harvesting Credit Card Numbers and Passwords from Your Site, and Here's How I Do It." And they walk through basically talking about how they could create some relatively unimportant component, get it jammed up into something, and have everybody putting it into their website. Nobody's looking at the code, and it's pretty scary, and I encourage you to go look it up and read it. But again, not long after that, we saw a new series of escalations of attacks. So this one here was a case where a popular library within Go, Go is unique in that it uses GitHub as the official repository. So all of the coordinates point to GitHub packages. And this developer, for one reason or another, decided they were done and they deleted their GitHub account. And GitHub did not prevent that same ID from being reclaimed and immediately reused by somebody else. And so what basically happened is this developer didn't really think through the implications of what happens if I just check out, what happens to my users, right? It's one thing to just simply stop publishing. It's another thing to basically hand the keys over to your factory, which is basically what happened. And so this GitHub ID was deleted and it was immediately reclaimed by somebody else. And so therefore all the social trust, all the karma, and the ability to publish new canonical versions of this particular thing happened almost immediately. And nobody really was paying attention to this. Reportedly, the person that reclaimed it was simply trying to fix a build late on a Friday night. But what if? What if this was an attack, right? And so none of the users would easily be able to spot the fact that the person who had previously been owning that ID and publishing stuff and was somewhat trustworthy had been replaced by somebody unknown, right? That is kind of scary. Then just a few weeks later in March, we saw that a popular package within NPM itself was actually directly compromised. So this was not a typo squat attack. This was an official package that had existed and was compromised and turned into a Monero miner. So everybody who downloaded and executed this package, again, developers, build infrastructures, and potentially users, if this was distributed, were now mining cryptocurrency. This was out there for a mere 36 hours. But again, since these things are directly monetizable, that was still money for whoever did it. It didn't matter that it was only 36 hours and not 2 weeks. They still made money. And so what do you think they're going to do? They're going to find more ways to do exactly that. But this was a dramatic escalation because it was no longer people poking around or leveraging mistakes or accidental things or latent issues in the components like we saw within Struts and Commons Collections. This was the intentional injection and creation of a new malicious attack that was immediately being exploited, right? For me, that's like a whole new ballgame. And then just a few weeks after that, in May, we saw a similar thing, but this was a backdoor that had been discovered in an NPM Get Cookies module that had been published since March. So this had been out there for several months, and it had an intentional backdoor published in it. It's unclear how or why that got there. But what's interesting is this was itself a combination of the two previous attacks that we talked about. So the Get Cookies module was put out there and created. It was a new module, but they probably discovered like, okay, I don't have any users. So the creation of a package and dropping it into the repo in and of itself doesn't get people exploited. But in parallel to that, somehow somebody had a changed mail parser, another NPM package, and added this get cookies module as a dependency to it. And so an official package now was directly depending upon and including a pretend malicious package. There wasn't even an attempt to hide it and put code in to make it look like get cookies was being used. It was merely just included as a dependency in the package.json, right? So then that happened, and now they've got users. And all of those websites and applications that are deployed now have a backdoor in them. And then, literally, you can't make this up, within just a few weeks after that, there was a discovery of a Python module called SSH Decorator, who was stealing private SSH keys and streaming them off to Eastern Europe somewhere, right? And so this one is sort of a culmination of a number of different things. So this was an official module who was out there, who somehow got code injected in it to do it. It's unclear even today how exactly that happened. The developer of this module took a ton of heat from the ecosystem, and I think actually just basically left and unpublished this thing. So it just like went away. So it's unclear if this was intentional or if he got hacked. But what's interesting is, what better place to hide something stealing SSH private keys than a module whose job is to help you SSH to other things from Python? So if you did have tripwires of something looking at, you know, should this application be touching SSH keys? Should it be opening ports and things like that? You would expect that behavior. It's not going to trigger any flags, right? So again, this really points to a dramatic escalation and sophistication of the attackers looking at the packages that are out there and figuring out which ones should I go after that are the either going to get me, you know, the widest audience the fastest, or are going to be the least noticed for the longest. And so who knows how many people's keys got stolen and what they're going to do with those keys next. But these things don't just, you know, happen in isolation, right? So taken together, what we've basically seen is that we've seen a dramatic escalation in the Equifax instance of how quickly attackers go and exploit a particular vulnerability, a latent vulnerability. And by the way, it wasn't just Equifax that had been attacked within days of this. Literally just a month ago, the NSA issued a report that talked about how the U.S. Department of Defense also was being probed within 2 days of that particular Struts vulnerability. They pointed the finger at Russia, right? So whether it's a nation state sponsored attack or just happens to be a crime syndicate in Russia, I don't think any of us will know. But you know, these are highly sophisticated, highly motivated attackers. And so what we're basically seeing are these three things coming together. We have an increased open source usage, which is generally a good thing. At the same time, we've seen a massive lowering of the bar of the sophistication of people who are creating those packages, publishing those packages, and how diligent they are with their own credentials and making sure that they're actually good passwords and not password and not checking them into GitHub. So that trend is happening. At the same time, we've seen and are in the midst of a massive explosion of highly funded, highly profitable crime syndicates. And we've seen the introduction of cryptocurrency, which now allows all of those attacks to be directly monetized, which means we're just now seeing the tip of the iceberg. This is just starting to happen. So unfortunately, that slide that I have that walks that timeline, it's just going to keep getting longer. And so we need to recognize this as users of open source, as the publishers of open source, as open source developers. You need to think about this. You need to think about when you get attacked personally, potentially all of the users of any of the code you've written and published also potentially get attacked. If your keys and your passwords get compromised, so do they, right? And so we have this massive amplifying effect. Every developer wants to have a profound impact on the world. And that's why we are motivated to create open source. It's awesome to be able to create something and get thousands and millions of users. It's highly not awesome when those thousands and millions of users potentially get compromised because of something you may have done or not done. And it's even worse if somebody dies because a hospital gets attacked. And so as open source developers, you know, please pay attention to this, think about it. As open source consumers, you need to be aware that this is what's happening. You need to be able to pay attention to this and protect yourself for when, not if, these types of things will happen. And it starts by paying attention to the open source components that your developers are using, having build manifests and you know, package manifests and bill of materials, so that when an announcement comes out that there is a new vulnerability or an intentional directed attack at a particular component, you have a chance of knowing, am I using this? Where am I using it? How do I respond? Right? That's how you have to be able to protect yourself with this. And Brian? So, Mark, yeah, I'm done. So
that was perfect. Thank you so much.